To ensure a thorough assessment, it is best to perform the musculoskeletal exam of the knee in a systematic way. The following is a suggested order of exam that incorporates many of the common techniques used for evaluating knee injuries. Begin the exam with the patient in the standing position. Look for evidence of gross deformity, muscular atrophy, symmetry of the patellar alignment, evidence of varus or valgus positioning of the knee, or presence of pes planus and pes cavus of the foot. From a posterior view, observe for more than two toes laterally, also called the too many toes sign. This can indicate an overpronated foot or an abducted forefoot. Have the patient perform a toe raise and evaluate the heel position. Normally, the heel should change from a neutral to a varus position. Next, observe the gait, looking for an antalgic gait or excessive pronation or supination. Next, evaluate active range of motion. If pain or limitation exists, repeat the range of motion passively. In a seated position, test for knee extension. In this position, also observe patellar tracking. And internal and external rotation of the hip, which can help identify referred knee pain caused by hip pathology. Also in the seated position, palpate anatomic landmarks for tenderness. Palpate the distal quadriceps, quadriceps tendon, the patella, and patellar tendon. The tibial tuberosity, and the fat pads beneath the patella. On the medial side, palpate the medial collateral ligament, the medial joint line, the pes anserine bursa, and on the lateral side, the lateral collateral ligament, the lateral joint line, and the fibular head. Posteriorly, palpate the popliteal fossa and the distal hamstrings. With the patient supine, the leg can be fully extended to assess better for joint effusion. Compress the suprapatellar pouch, pushing the contents distally, and assess for increased fluid. Patellar ballotment can also be performed by compressing the patella and releasing quickly. Observe for rapid rebound, which also indicates increased fluid pressure. If a click or tap is felt, a large effusion is present, also called the blottable patella. The patellar grind test assesses for patellofemoral syndrome. With the knee extended, push the patella into the trochlear groove of the femur. Pain is a positive test. The patellar inhibition test assesses for patellofemoral syndrome also. With the knee extended, push the superior aspect of the patella inferiorly as the patient tightens the quadriceps muscle. Pain or crepitus is considered a positive test. The patellar apprehension test evaluates for patellar subluxation or dislocation. With the knee extended, push medially and laterally on the patella in an attempt to sublux the patella. If it is painful or the patient becomes apprehensive about the movement, it is a positive test. There are several tests commonly performed to evaluate for ligamentous laxity of the knee. Medial collateral ligament stability can be tested at 0 degrees and 30 degrees of flexion by applying a valgus force on the knee. Lateral collateral ligament stability can also be tested at 0 degrees and 30 degrees of flexion by applying a varus force to the knee. Laxity indicates a partial or complete ligamentous tear. The Lachman's test evaluates for a tear of the anterior cruciate ligament. With the knee flexed to 30 degrees, stabilize the femur and pull the proximal tibia anteriorly. Excessive motion or soft endpoint is a positive test. The anterior drawer test assesses for a tear of the anterior cruciate ligament also. With the knee flexed to 90 degrees and the foot planted on the table, push the proximal tibia anteriorly. Excessive motion or soft endpoint is a positive test. The posterior drawer test assesses for a tear of the posterior cruciate ligament. With the knee flexed at 90 degrees and the foot planted on the table, push the proximal tibia posteriorly. Excessive motion or a soft endpoint is a positive test. The Pcl Sag test evaluates for a tear of the posterior cruciate ligament. With both knees flexed to 90 degrees and feet planted on the table, view the knees from the side to compare the position of the tibia. Increased posterior sag of one of the tibia is considered a positive test. The Macmurray's test evaluates for a meniscal tear. With the patient supine and knee fully flexed, palpate the medial joint line and apply an axial force along the tibia while externally rotating and extending the knee. This maneuver is repeated, palpating the lateral joint line while internally rotating the foot. Pain, catching, or palpable clunk indicates a meniscal tear. The bounce test also evaluates for a meniscal tear. Grasp the heel, extend and bounce the leg, gently forcing hyperextension. Pain is a positive test. In the prone position, Apley's compression test evaluates for a meniscal tear. Flex the knee to 90 degrees, apply an axial force along the tibia, and rotate the tibia. Pain is a positive test. Obrist test assesses for iliotibial band syndrome. With the patient in the lateral position, the knee is supported and flexed to 90 degrees. Then extend and abduct the hip and release the knee support. Failure of the knee to adduct is a positive test. In the seated position, Noble's test can also be used to evaluate for iliotibial band syndrome. With the knee flexed to 90 degrees, apply pressure over the lateral femoral condyle and passively extend the knee. Lateral pain around 30 degrees of flexion is a positive test. In concluding the knee exam, it's important to document a neurovascular exam. Here we demonstrate dorsalis pedis artery pulse, posterior tibial artery pulse, and capillary refill testing. A more thorough exam may be indicated based on patient history.